A very good evening to all. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you all the wonderful webinar by Worldwide Fund India in associate with Indian Dragonfly Society and Bombay Natural History Society and co-organized by Eco Club of NEC, National Engineering College, Kovilpatti, Tamil Nadu. And also specially thanks to all the title sponsors of this webinar. I extend my warm welcome to all the speakers and participants of this webinar today. If speech is silver, silence is gold. When you start speaking, the seeds of words are grown in the listener's heart. Likewise, we all have gathered here to be discussed on the today's topic, Dragonflies and Humans. It will be more immense and honor lectures will be given by the special volunteer on Worldwide Fund India. It will be a chance to think very minutely on all the aspects which have resulted in harming the environment around us. I'm sure in today's session, we will be discussing all the merits and demerits, such like and alarming points to start protecting the dragonflies and safe abounding between us. Through this webinar, participants will not only be more alert and aware of their surroundings, but it will be helpful in their personal development to improve ourselves and also ensure you all that will thoroughly enjoy the session of this webinar. Definitely, we all take some learnings to home today. Now, I'm proudly welcome to the today's star and the special guest of this webinar, Mr. Subham Nagar, a volunteer at Worldwide Fund, and also he is an active volunteer in Corbin Initiative Forum. He completed his schooling in Kendriya Vidyalaya Kernel and DAV Public School in Kurukshetra. He did his higher studies in Hansraj College of Delhi University, BSc Honors Anthropology. And now he is an active volunteer, native speaker, and highly capable, a motivated student, very optimistic, and also great in patience. Now, an excellent and charming drawing, a very diagrammatic representation of a person, and also a good listener, very good personality. Hopeful thinking can get you out of fear zone into an appreciation zone. So, the real man of India who put his hard work and now he shines like a star. Last but not least, I welcome in the star evening of today, Mr. Subham Narwal sir, can give a speech. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So, myself, Subham Narwal, as Jaya has mentioned. So, thank you for this beautiful introduction. And as she has already mentioned about me, so I am a second year undergraduate student pursuing my bachelor's in veterinary medicine from Indian Veterinary Research Institute, Bareilly. And I am an active volunteer of WWF from past 6 months. I joined WWF in 14th August 2020, at the time when this festival was instigated. At the same time, I had joined this WWF. So let's start with my presentation. So WWF is celebrating this Dragonfly Festival for the third time. In the past 2 years, we used to celebrate this festival in the Delhi region, but this time we had expanded our horizon to all over the India. We are celebrating it to Assam, Delhi, Gujarat, Hyderabad, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, Madhya Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal. This time we got support of Indian Dragonfly Society and Bombay Natural History Society. We are also co-supported by National Biodiversity Authority of India, UNDP, IUCN, CEP, Time for Nature, World Environment Day, UN Environment Programme, and Columbia 2020. So, let's start. This is my very first slide. So, what is the name of this creature? You can write, and I am reading your responses. We get first response from Roshni Sanji that it is a dragonfly. Any other else? Well, it is not a dragonfly. It is a different creature. So, what is the name of this creature? I will tell in my further slide. And why this creature is not dragonfly would be clear after this presentation. So, it is a damselfly. Damselfly, what damselflies are and how it is differentiated from dragonfly would be clear in my further slide. So, let's move. So dragonfly and damselfly are one of the most beautiful insects. They are very colorful and have a very nice, interesting behavior, which would attract you towards its beauty. So they are aquatic insects that belong to insect order Odonata. As you had read in your 9th or 10th classes, there is an animal kingdom in subject. So at that time, you might know that there is a kingdom that is known as Animalia. Then we have some sort of phylum. So, a dragonfly belongs to the phylum Arthropoda. After that, we move, the class comes. So, it is an insect. So, it is belonging from the class Insecta. And then, the other. So, order is Odonata. What does Odonata mean? It is a Greek word that means tooth one. So, dragonfly is having a serrated tooth. So, that's why the dragonfly comes under the order Odonata. So, they are not only beautiful, but so very important for our ecosystem. Aquatic insects belong to the insect Odonata, which is a Greek for tooth one, referring to dragonfly's serrated tooth. When they eat, dragonfly most often snatch flying insects in mid-air, tear them into bits, smash the bits into a bowl and chow down. So they are aquatic insects. They are aquatic insects because they need to lay their eggs in the water. Without laying their egg in water, they are not able to complete their life cycle. The dragonfly body is divided into three parts, that is head, thorax and abdomen. And there are more than 5,000 species in all over the world. And in India alone, 499 species have been identified, which are categorized among the 18 families. And if I talk about to the Delhi, in only the Delhi, there are 51 recorded species of dragonfly. So let's discuss about some regarding to their natural history. So they just evolved in the Carboniferous era, which is a evolutionary history. So Carboniferous era is a part of the late Paleozoic era. In the layman terms, I can say they just evolved around 325 million years ago. And at that time, they have a wingspan size. So their wing size is around 2 feet. But it has tremendously reduced to 2 to 5 inches. So when you see the today's dragonfly, their wing size is 2 to 5 inches. But at the conventional time, when we go in the past, around 325 million years back, their wing size is 2 feet. So their wing size span has been tremendously reduced from 2 feet to 2 to 5 inches. And what might be the reason? What do you think that reduction in wing size from 2 feet to 2 to 5 inches would happen? So what do you think about that? You can write. Okay, somebody is writing to fly. So, with the 2 feet wing, does this dragonfly cannot fly? If they have a large wing size, they can't fly with the large wing size. Was it because of the less use of wings, just like my mark theory, and use and disuse? Okay. So, it is not a Lamarck theory. Rather than writing for a Lamarck theory, I would like to say it is an evolution, adaptation. It is not because use and disuse. Dragonflies are constantly using their wings for flying purposes. In fact, they are the first flying arthropods. That is, they are the first flying insects that has been reported. So there are some problems with the wing size. The problems are, if you have a large wing size, first of all, you do not get a good speed. So you are thinking that a big wing will give a more speed, but this is not the case. It will happen in that thing when you have a bone. Dragonfly doesn't have the bones. They doesn't contain any kind of endoskeleton. They have exoskeleton. Exoskeleton means the outer covering of chitin all over the body. So supporting such a large size is a difficult task. Secondly, just think yourself. If you have a very colorful dress and you are moving in a road, then you will be noticed by everyone in your surrounding. So dragonflies are colorful nature. And just think, you have a weird violet color dress and moving in the road, and you are a fatty person, so you will be noticed more as such, rather than some, you can sort now, bodies have suit some sort of colors. So in the same case is happening here. If you have a large wing size span and you have a bright colorful body, you will be definitely identified by your predators. So what does predator means? The animals which eat, the animals which attack them, like the dragonflies, they birds or ducks or some sort of frogs. So these, they're predators. So they're predator that easily identify if they have a large wing size. So the wing size should be reduced with the time, as some mutation has happened in all over the past and it got selected by the nature. Just a natural selection theory. So the reduction in wing size happened. The third thing is that if they have a less wing size, they can move much faster. They can have a much more movement. So they can move upward, forward, downward, backward. They can present any kind of movement. It is the very unique feature of dragonfly. So reduction in wing size span has given this benefit to them. Okay. So what are oryx? So they are prehistoric roots, more than 300 million years old. So they are the first winged insects to evolve. And they are the aquatic insects, belong to the insect order Odonata. As I mentioned, aquatic because they are laying their eggs in the water. And first wing insects. So somebody was saying use and disuse. That is wrong because they are the first wing insect. And they use 80% of their brain for visual acuity. They can see objects up to 30 feet away and detect movement as far as 60 feet away. And in their single eye, there is some, you can say, a small structure that is known as the ometidia. Whenever you will see, you will see the dragonfly eye. It is just like you are seeing the sunflower middle, and it is bifurcated in small thing. Like that, their eyes are. So that structure is known as the ometidia. So there are 28,000 ometidia in a single eye. 28,000. And means they have 28,000 eyes forming one large structure. It's better to mention that. So just completing a whole structure, whole set. So 28,000 ometidia in a single eye, and their 80% brain is using for the visual acuity. So that's why they have very excellent vision. they can see objects up to 30 feet away and detect movement as far as 60 feet away. In addition, this vision will help in to save themselves from their predators, to find their partner for the reproductive process, and even to identify their prey. So what does prey mean? Prey is the thing which on which dragonfly will be eating. Like dragonfly will be eating the mosquito. So dragonfly is predator and the mosquito is prey. So it will help to identify their prey as well. Okay. So let's discuss the morphology of the dragonfly. So morphology means the study of external structure. So dragonfly is body is divided in three parts, as I mentioned: head, thorax, and abdomen. So here is the head, then prothorax, then synthorax, and there are three pairs of legs: one pair of front leg, one pair of middle leg, and one pair of hind leg. Four set of wings. So one pair of fore wings and one pair of hind wings. The wings are generally transparent in nature. So the lines which appeared in the dragonflies, these are known as nodes. And there is one structure present on the dragonfly wing on the upper side that is known as stigma or pterostigma. Then their body is divided into 10 segments. So it's segment 3, S3, segment 5, S5, segment 7, S7, segment 10, S10, like that. So in the very first picture, when you are telling me that it is a dragonfly, so now you would be more clear that why it is not a dragonfly, it is a damselfly. So there is a basic difference between the dragonfly and damselfly. Dragonfly body is bulkier. You can see that their body is bulkier in nature. But damselfly body is slim and a needle-like body, a needle-like long body. And the wings are folded when dragonfly resting. So you can see the wings are folded. But the wings are open when dragonfly is resting. And the wing size is same in case of the damselfly, but it is of different size in case of the dragonfly. The forewing is smaller and hind wing is larger. And the you can see the eye structure. The compound eye is a bit narrower, but closely related, appear to be one. But in case of damselfly, they are the farly separated and far away. So this is the difference between a dragonfly and damselfly. One more difference is there, that is a biological difference. The antehumeral and humeral stripes, they are horizontal in damselfly, but they are vertical in dragonfly. I will show a chart and it would be more clearer to you. So see, fore wings and hind wings are unequal in size. See, the fore wing is smaller and hind wing is larger. So fore wing and hind wings are equal in size in case of damselfly. So fore wing and hind wings are equal in size. In dragonfly, wings have a broad base. See this base. The base is broader in case of the dragonfly. But the base of the wings are narrower in case of the damselfly. Hind wings are broader at the base than the fore wings. See, this hind wing that is on the back side is much broader at the base side from the fore wing. You can see the fore wing is smaller. So, while resting, wings folded. But while resting, wings are outstretched in case of dragonfly while resting. So, bulky body in comparison with damselfly. But it looked like a needle and slim body in comparison with the dragonfly. And eyes are larger, covering most of the head and appear joint in case of dragonfly. But in case of damselflies, eyes are large and widely separated. Okay, so this is the difference. That's why the first picture which I had shown in the webinar is not a dragonfly, it is a damselfly. So let's discuss the life cycle of a dragonfly. So dragonfly life cycle is divided in five parts: adult, mating, egg laying, larva, and emergence. So let's discuss one by one. Adult is fast flying and maneuverable aerial predators. So they move fast and maneuverable means they can move here and there. They can move at any place due to their wings. Seen both near and away from the water, males are usually territorial. Territorial means living to the land area. So males are usually territorial because female has to lay the eggs. As I told na, ki dragonflies are aquatic. But why they are aquatic? Because they need to lay their eggs in the water body. So female has to lay the eggs. That's why male can be territorial. So males are usually territorial. So dragonfly live for around 1 to 8 weeks as adult. Now discuss about the mating. So it takes place in the wheel formation. You can see a wheel forming. It takes in wheel formation. Male clasps female behind the head and she brings her abdomen up to meet him. She may take few minutes or several hours. Now egg laying. Females may lay egg alone or in tandem. So tandem is a very common behavior in case of dragonfly. I will show in the further slide a picture of tandem. And you have noticed the tandem in your surrounding. But you don't know the scientific name or the scientific reason behind that. And it would be clearer when I will move further. So some release eggs freely into the water and other insert them into the plant material. So larva. The male life stage, the aquatic larvas, lives underwater for between 3 months to 5 years, although usually 2 to 3 years. Voracious predator. Voracious means they need food during their growth time, so they eat as much as they can. They shed their skin. Shedding of skin in case of the arthropod is known as molting. So they shed their skin or they molt up to 18 times as they grow. Found in almost all wetland habitats. So let's talk about the emergence, the final step. So larva climb out of the water, usually on plant stem, and emerge from the larva skin to become an adult. The process takes several hours and it will be a few days before the adult is fully dried and colored up. So this is the life cycle of the dragonfly. So the feeding behavior, they consume 10 to 15% of their own weight per day. Both are equivalent to getting a cat to solve your mouse problem. Males are voracious eaters, happily dining on mosquito larva and others. So as I told, males are voracious means they need some food during their growth. So voracious, here the term is repeating itself. Happily dining on the larva, so names, or you can say larva are eating on the mosquito's larva. That's why they are voracious. So let's discuss the mating behavior. Here you can see a photograph. So can you tell me which one is male or which one is female? Okay, somebody is writing, red one is male. This role, writing the roll number is compulsory. I don't know, everybody is writing their roll number. It is your, I think, internal matter. So the red one is male. The answer is right. So why are you thinking red one is male? if you are thinking, due to the color, the red one is male and the lower one is female, then it is wrong. Your answer is right that the upper one is male and the lower one is female. But they are male and female because not of their color, due to their anatomical feature. Anatomical feature is that the pseudopenis or the structure which is, you are writing males are usually colored to attract females for breeding. Yes. But this is not the science, this is not the reason behind that. Here is comes a different reason. So the reason behind is that there is a pseudopenis which is located in the second abdominal segment of the male, and the ovipositor, the female reproductive organ, is located in the ninth segment. So here you can see upper one, second abdominal segment will come there, and when you move S3, S4, S5, S6, S7 and up to S9, on the S9 you will find the ovipositor. That's why they are mating. And one more interesting thing is that the sperm formation does not take place in the second abdominal segment of the male. It takes place in the ninth abdominal segment. So here the sperms will form. How will male transfer its sperm is that it will bend its ninth abdominal segments toward the second abdominal segment. Once he gets transfer his sperm to the second abnormal segment and release all enzymes which is required for maturing those sperm, the male is ready for the copulation or mating. And then male will come and transfer his sperm from second abnormal segment to the ovipositor of the female on the segment. So, dragonfly sex is rough and tumble affair. Their sexual coupling requires flexibility and acrobatic skill. Female may get bitten, male gets scratched, sperms wind up everywhere. These strange mating habits have survived millions of years of evolution. So, there is no courtship ritual. Courtship ritual is that you are writing them, it's like a peacock to attract opposite gender. So, this is the courtship ritual. Showing off some sort of good colors. Like some words used to do dance or some release some kind of hormones or some smelling substance which attracts their counterpart, whether male or female. So this does not happen in case of the dragonfly generally. But in some species, a male will display his color or flies over his territory to show a potential. Now you can see this photograph. Both male and female are of same color. So how you will tell which one is male or which one is female? So that is the courtship ritual. If the male is get his color or show some kind of potential by flying like that. So here there is no courtship ritual. This is what I was referring in my previous slide as tandem. So you might have seen dragonfly in such a position. So what here is happening is that male is holding the female prothorax, from the anal appendages that is located here. So this position is known as the tandem. Dragonflies have an extraordinarily good vision which helps to find female partner. So as I told earlier that they use their 80% of brain for visual acuity and they have 28,000 omitidia in their single eye. So they have very good vision. So they use it for finding their female partner. So how dragonfly mate in leaf formation? So mate in flight or hold on to her thorax with his leg. If he is feeling thirsty, he might bite her. He pulls his abdomen forward and uses his anal appendages, a pair of cerci, to clasp her by the neck. So her prothorax. So he extends his body and continues to fly with her in tandem. This is what tandem look like. So position during copulation is known as wheel position. So this is the copulation, a wheel is forming, and this one is tandem. The male is holding the female from his anal appendages to her prothorax. Okay. So now that he got hold of mate, they don't store sperm near the copulatory organ. Some sperm form gonophore on his ninth abdominal segment to his penis, which is located under his second abdominal segment. Once he charges his seminal vesicle with sperm, he is ready to go. Female genital opening is near the tip of the abdomen. So how do adult dragonflies hunt? So there are three techniques to find and capture the prey. One is hawking, second is trailing, and third one is cleaning. So what does hawking mean? Hawking means that you have to catch the dragonfly in the air. You have to smash them, beat them, throw them to a bowl and eat them in the air. So everything is happening in the air. So that is the hawking. A dragonfly will catch the mosquito in the air, bite them through their teeth, eat them, smash them in the small pieces and make a bowl and then eat. That is the hawking. Second is the trailing. So trailing is a method that is very common. You have seen the tiger or a snake. Just sit on a quiet location and just wait for the prey to come. Once the prey will come, it will attack over them. The same is the trailing. And the third one is the gleaning. So gleaning is that a dragonfly move around the plant material. If they see a insect or a caterpillar-like thing on the plant material, they will eat. They will attack them, eat them. That is the gleaning third. So how to bring in dragonfly and damselfly to your locality? So the dragonfly's bodies are dragonflies are water bodies friendly. So what happens that if you have a water body in your locality, then dragonfly would be attracted. So ponds should not need to be large, nor require filter, but it needs several key features. The key features like wind protected area. So it should be in wind protected areas because if dragonfly is laying their eggs or they are just in the egg laying process, and a strong wind is blowing, so their egg will blow around to their surrounding parts like plant material, or they might be flying far due to the air, due to the pressure of that air. And they need 5 to 6 hours of midday sun. So as the same thing is that the snakes come out of the holes, so they can increase their body temperature. That's why they need a 5 to 6 hours of midday sun. Depth vary from very shallow at the edges to about 2 feet at its deepest level. So how to select the plant and how to create an artificial ecosystem at your home? So it's very simple. Just take a water tub and fill it with the fresh water and plant it with the plants like lotus or nymphia, duckweed, hydrilla, utricularia, such plant. This one is lotus. These are the utricularia. So just plant them with this. What will it will do that? It will attract the dragonflies. The dragonfly will come and will lay their eggs. Once they will lay their eggs, the further process will carry out. And once these eggs get matured and a final product is released, that adult is happening, you get a dragonfly in your surrounding. So how this dragonfly would help you? As we all are humans, so we does not do anything without any benefit. So what is the benefit behind it? The main benefit behind that is if you will have dragonfly in your surrounding, the mosquito population in your surrounding would be reduced by 50 to 60%, and you will get free from those diseases such as dengue, malaria or chikungunya, which are prone. Today, we have a good medical infrastructure, we have the medicine, we have the treatment, but still we are struggling from such conventional diseases like dengue or chikungunya or malaria. What is the reason? The reason is that dragonfly population has been reduced due to the pollution in the water bodies, so they do not able to complete their life cycle, and it is indirectly increasing the mosquitoes population in your surrounding. And what would be the treatment will do if you have a more mosquito in your surrounding? You just get treat from your malaria, then another malaria mosquito will bite you, and then you are again in the hospital. So if the number of mosquito population is less in your surrounding and this dragonfly, you will be less prone to those diseases. So if you are creating an artificial ecosystem at your home or you are having a pond, so you should ensure that that where dragonfly are breeding, they does not have the fishes, frogs or ducks. Otherwise, they will eat their eggs, nymphs and even the dragonfly. So these creatures will prey on nymphs and eggs. all poison and fertilizer, even the insecticide, should be out of the water. What is the importance of dragonfly? Why WWF is emphasizing on such a small insect? Why we are celebrating a 6-month festival on this insect for 3 consecutive years? So this is the reason behind that. They are the valued as predator that help to control population of harmful insects such as mosquito, which spread dangerous diseases such as dengue, malaria, and chikungunya. Dragonfly mostly survives in pure and clean water. This assures purity and cleanness of water, which we may consume without any filter. Dragonfly are important at both the stages, whether it is terrestrial or aquatic. When they are aquatic, the aquatic larva feed on mosquito eggs, larvae, and adult feeds on the adult mosquito. So this is from my side. And now you can see there is one app that is known as the iNaturalist app. So what iNaturalist app is that if you see a dragonfly or a damselfly in your society or in your locality, just click a photograph from your phone and upload it to this app. Once you get upload, you will get the name of that particular species that this dragonfly name is, that it belongs from that species, and what is their food habit or what does they eat. You will get information about the dragonfly and damselfly. But what more do you get from this app? So one more thing is that we are running a competition simultaneously with this webinar series. That is one student or a person who will upload the maximum observation on this app will be awarded with a WWF certificate and a gift hamper from the WWF. And it will also help us. How it will help us? It will help us in the way that we will get the data that this particular species of dragonfly will be found in that particular area with that particular geographical surrounding, that climate, that weather. So we get the information, more information about those dragonfly, and we can locate them at that particular place. So it is called as Citizen Science Data Project. So with your help, we can complete it. And you can participate indirectly, and you will get a WWF certificate. So thank you. Warm regards from the Shubham Narwal and from Indian Veterinary Research Institute. Good day. And now you can ask your queries. Whatever your queries, you can just ask me. Instead of using mosquito repellents, can we use dragonflies to control mosquitoes? Yes, rather than using the mosquito repellent is for your safety. But what this dragonfly will do, that if you have a 100 population of your mosquito in your surrounding and you have dragonfly as well in your surrounding, so that 100 number will reduce to 40 or 30. So you have less chances even if you are not having a mosquito repellent on your body, you have less chances of biting due to the less population. Just a simple step. And does mosquito repellent kill dragonfly instant mosquito? No. The mosquito repellents are specifically, even mosquito repellent doesn't kill the mosquitoes. Mosquito repellent that you apply on your skin. And if you talk about that motin or that stuff, that is specifically designed for the mosquitoes due to their smelling senses or such kind of thing. So it will not kill the dragonfly. Whether we use dragonflies to control other living insects? Yes, we are using dragonfly. Does not need only feeding on the mosquitoes. They are feeding on the ectoparasites which are present on the skin of the cattle. You have seen, might be some of you have seen a, you can say, dragonflies are roaming around that cattle or some horses. So they are eating those things. Any other uses? So any other uses is that if you have more dragonfly in your locality, you will have more birds. Why more birds? Because dragonfly is also a food of birds. So thus, we need to get more beautified because are less, and the unwanted insects which are present in your locality will be reduced. Yes, the entomologist is doing the PhD on the dragonflies if they are choosing. You have to check the specific institute which is offering an entomology degree. There you can find that they what is their model insect. So it might be dragonfly also. So some people are doing the research on dragonfly. From there we get this data due to their research. Yes, dragonfly usually fly in a swarm, or you can say in a connective group. They it is very difficult to spot a dragonfly singularly. Most of the time they are in groups. As they are laying eggs in a numerous number, so those eggs get matured at the same time, and they are getting matured and becoming adult at the same time. So they move in a group. Any other query? Simple reason. Your water body is polluted. It is polluted with the stuff of the fertilizer or human or industrial waste. There is no fresh water present. So they are not able to complete their life cycle. Their number has been reduced due to non-completion of their reproductive cycle. This is the reason behind this extinction of these dragons. So I had dropped my mail ID. If you have any further query, just write to my mail and I will be happy to answer your query. And it would be a great matter that you had taken the interest and asking the question. Unique features of dragonfly, because dragonfly can partially fly even using their wings, but it looks like faster than your solution. Unique features. They have the pterostigma, so stigma. So it is the characteristics of Odonata, which is the inertial regulator, or you can say a regulator of their wing structure. Here in this picture you can see this is the stigma or pterostigma. So rather than saying partially fly, they are flying as per their need. That is not a partially or fully flying. Partially flying is that you are flying somewhat, everything has its own limit. If an insect, their wings support that much height, they are flying at that height. Even they used to do migration. They moved to Europe. There is one species of dragonfly that complete their life cycle. They migrate in the Europe. So that is not the case, that there is some, what you can say, partial. And faster, yes, they are faster. That's why their wing size has been reduced. Their wings are transparent, their wings are less, and they can perform any kind of movement. They can move forward, backward, upward, downward. So this has given them additional skill. Plus, they are good acrobats, as their body is separated in the segment, so they are more flexible. This is the reason. And one more thing is that they does not bite you. They do not contain any kind of sting. They do not contain any kind of... they do not contain of any kind of, you can say, a poison, some sort. So they will not bite you. If even they bite, you don't need to worry. It is only to the order Hymenoptera. 30 feet per minute is the speed. Average speed. And it depends on species to species. It might be increase or decrease. Well, I didn't listen that. Is there any particular species which is laying their eggs in the salt water till now? Even during orientation, such exception was not taught to me, so I can't comment on this question because such kind of dragonfly is not in my notice. So I think we should wrap this session, and you can post your further queries to my mail. And if you have more queries, you can just write. So thank you for listening to me, and I'm very happy that you had asked a lot of questions, and they are very interesting questions for me as well.
I, on behalf of entire organization here together, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty gratitude to all the speakers for gracing your important work and sharing with us your findings and opinions today. A big thank you to Mr. Shubham Narwal for his efforts towards dragonflies and humans. We are all inspired by your great words, sir. I also extend my thanks to WWF India, Indian Dragonfly Society, Bombay National Historical Society, and our special thanks to our title sponsors, Indian Dragonfly Society, Times for Nature, International Union for Conservation of Nature, Commission on Education and Communication, Columbia 2020 Biodiversity, World Environment Day, UN Environment, United Nations Development Program, for the enormous cooperation in the organization of this event. I couldn't thank everyone enough for their involvement and their willingness to take on the completion of the task beyond their comfort zones. We have been fortunate enough to be backed up by a team of very motivated and dedicated colleagues of Echo Club who know their job and are result oriented. We thank you for being with us in this evening. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you.